All right.
So thank you guys for coming, first of all. I'm going to introduce myself to all you guys, and this year is going to be great, but I always like to start off anytime I'm meeting typically new parents and new students. And in the future, just so you know, students are invited to these events always. It's not necessarily that they can't make it, they got practice, if they have a big test they're studying for, definitely prioritize that. But if they're sitting at home playing video games, try to get them to come, because one thing you'll learn in high school is the student is actually the one that's ultimately responsible for all the stuff that we're talking about. It's great information for you guys to have as parents to help enforce it at home and help know what's going on. But ultimately, they're the ones that are going to be doing the work, as it's been through middle school and elementary school as well. But it really steps up in high school. But I always like to just introduce myself because I get to know certain things about parents and students and families, and sometimes school people sometimes feel like an enigma that we live at school and don't have anything else going on. So I like to share a few personal things about who I am, just so you guys know a little background about me. So I moved up here in 2012. That was my first year. This is my first full year of students going through, starting from freshman all the way to this graduating class. So that's fairly exciting for me. I moved up from Pismo Beach. My wife and I went to Cal Poly. I did not finish at Cal Poly. I started as an aerospace engineer, going through Cal Poly. Did 2 years there and decided that that was not the path that I really liked to be on. So I did a complete 180 flip-flop. I went from doing high-level calculus in physics year five to macaroni art and Venn diagrams, going through liberal studies and teacher education. I went straight from there. I never wanted to be a teacher. I have two parents that are teachers. I never wanted to grow up being a teacher. I knew that I couldn't handle. Hey, come on in. Couldn't handle the same kids in the classroom, I think, every single day. But I knew that I wanted to work in a school. I really liked the education system, and I wanted to become, I knew that, thought back to my high school days and thought, well, who's the other teachers, who are the coolest people on campus? And I thought, well, my high school counselor is pretty cool. So I went straight from my bachelor's degree into my master's degree in credential and completed that. And then North Tahoe High School was actually my first, after grad school and internship experiences and that kind of thing, was my first true position as a counselor. So this is my fourth year up here and fourth year in the gig. And yeah, there's a bunch of stuff here in case you guys didn't grab it. Anything you guys want to grab, you don't have to take it all, but it's a bunch of good information. And I am passing around a sign-in sheet, just so you know. And then I do ask if you guys have your email address. You don't have to put that there, but if you want to sign up for, I have a separate mailing list if you want to sign up for that. Just hit yes in your email in there and I'll make sure to add you. I am married, if I didn't mention. So essentially my wife, we've been married, this is our fifth year being married, and we live in Incline. So one big thing that I learned from my background that I like to share with students is plans do change. I know many, many people that started off with one college track and changed to something completely different halfway through or even after graduating with a degree, and that's okay. So that's something big I like to tell students is plans really do change. Again, I've been married 5 years, I don't have any kids yet. So I don't have that personal experience, and I do get asked that, you don't have kids, so you must not know. I like to say I have 360 kids every single year, so I have a good amount of experience, but I don't have that at-home experience, which is a valuable piece of insight that parents have. So I do value the input that you guys have, any insight that you guys have that you would like to share wisdom with me. I do appreciate it, but I do have a dog child, which is, we have very similar conversations about a child as a newborn, so I'd say it's a good practice for sometime in the future. Professionally, I've been doing a lot professionally in the 4 years I've been, going on 5 years I've been in the gig. I am a board member with the California Association of School Counselors, so we represent about 10,000 school counselors in the state of California. I run all their technology, social media, and do a lot of conference planning with them. I've spoken at dozens of conferences around the United States and kind of the Western region. So I speak at national counselor conferences to hundreds of school counselors about all kinds of different things from marketing to public speaking, as well as things like advocating for our profession. I'm also very fairly well-known. I write quite a bit about school counseling. So I have a very popular school counseling blog that I keep up with, share some of my insights and really like to just pour out some of my ideas into for other people to use as well. So that's kind of my professional background. Just quickly, I know you guys have had school counselors in the past, but because it's important to me, I like to make sure that I try to make it important to the people that I work with. But a school counselor sometimes has a vague job. We're kind of the jack of all trades at schools. We kind of fill in all the little holes. We wear 12 different hats. And really, we all have to have, any school counselor you come in contact with has to have a master's degree and a credential. That's a bare minimum. So we're all very well educated, but we're uniquely qualified through our training and experiences to address the entire domain of student kind of wellness, support, and academics. Okay, so we not only support their classes, their grades, their college aspirations, but we also support their career aspirations. We support students who are going through depression, anxiety. We're not therapists, but we do short-term interventions and counseling with students, but we don't provide therapy. So that's kind of a main difference from counseling and therapists outside that you might have in the community. And we do try. I'm really pushing it in our district right now is to develop what's called the comprehensive school counseling program district-wide that really has an umbrella approach to how we work with students and parents and our teachers and staff. So that's, in a nutshell, what is a school counselor? Obviously, we do a ton of other things. I was telling someone that right now I feel kind of like a secretary and doing all the paperwork and that kind of thing. So I kind of pretend like my real job actually starts in about a week and a half. But no, it's a very, very broad and varied type of job. I liken it to being a cop sometimes. I never know what's going to walk through my door on any given day. I could have all the best laid plans and many appointments, and a kid comes in and says, I'm thinking about committing suicide, and all those things go away. So it's a very fluid job as well. So that's all kind of about me and what my role is at school. But I wanted to go over, kind of just start with, how do you actually utilize my services? And what kind of services are you going to be looking for? So most of you guys might know, but I usually typically require and ask and plead for appointments. It just helps me keep my life sane and organized. And also, I found that it actually gives parents a better sense of like my committed time to you. So instead of like having kids constantly barreling in or many parents just waiting in the office, you have a specific set of time where you can pretty much be guaranteed, unless there's an emergency, that my attention is basically solely on you and your child and what you guys need. Okay, so that really just helps me keep things organized and make sure that I also serve all students as best I can. I do have a social media, and we have I keep a fairly up-to-date website. I haven't been on there super a lot since we've got back in the summer, but I do go through regularly and update the school counseling area of the website. I'll show you in just a second how to actually get there if you haven't seen it. But I do keep a Facebook counseling page that I send out reminders and updates, as well as Twitter if you're socially inclined. The biggest thing I have for parents is please do ask any questions that you guys might have of me, of the school. I might not have all the answers, but I know a lot of people, and I know a lot of things and resources that I usually can find an answer if I don't know it off the top of my head. So please do ask. Sometimes, though, I will give you work to do. Okay. Sometimes it's not just I don't have an answer, but sometimes I'll give you some kind of homework to go research and come back to me. We can have a further conversation about what you learned, and then we can kind of brainstorm the next steps from there. Okay. Let's see. So this is the website, just so you guys know. When you guys log on, and this stuff will sometimes change, but they're probably going to be keeping that top menu the same. And that's where you'll find this link. It's not doing my reflector thing. But the counseling menu is almost right in the middle, and it's a little pull down. And that's where you'll see a lot of links that you'll be able to access. So it looks like that. And then two places that you're going to want to look. This top link up here says make a counseling appointment. That's going to be the easiest place. It actually links to my live calendar. So you can see if I have appointments booked, if I set one in there right before you get in there, it's not going to be available. Or if I clear one off, it's going to be available for you. So it links to my live calendar. So you can see when I am actually available and when I'm not. There's information, I keep a counseling calendar. There's information about requesting transcripts or school profile. One other area that I want to kind of direct your attention is towards the bottom. And there, third from the bottom right now, there's a link that's called Handbooks, Guides, and Resources. Okay. The handbooks I have up right now are mainly for two-year and four-year college applications and advising handbooks. It's something that you can familiarize yourself with as freshmen, but just know many of the materials will probably be updated and changed by the time you actually need to use them. Okay. College advising, college admissions world is a very fast-paced, changing environment, especially in this year and next year and last year. Like, there's a lot of things changes. SATs are changing. We'll talk a bit about that. But There's also, the piece that I wanted to highlight is, I do keep what's called grade level resource folders, okay? And basically what that is, it's an open folder through Dropbox that you guys can all access. And I just start throwing, throughout the year as I get new information, new resources, I throw all that stuff in kind of a pseudo-organized folder that's shared with you. So you can hop on there and download anything from this presentation, I believe, should be on there. I hope I put it on there. If not, it'll be on there tomorrow morning. A PDF of this. There's other information, like some of these resources are up there. So just hop on there. But also these information is also available on a lot of websites. I just hopped on last hour and printed all this stuff out. And then if you actually click on the link, there's even more information. Okay, so even more stuff that you can access. So I would much rather give you all the information you can handle, and sometimes I do feel like a fire hose, just spitting the information out, and I realize that sometimes it's a little overwhelming. Tonight will probably be one of those times when it's probably going to be a little bit overwhelming. I'll just warn you right now. However, I want to make sure that you guys at least hear it. If you guys don't remember everything I say tonight, that's fine. But if next time we talk about it, it kind of rings a bell in the back of your mind, that's what I'm really looking for. All right. If there's something super important that I think you need to remember, I'll make sure that's noted, like this will be on the test or something like that. A few things that I always like to cover are the three norms. All right, and this is not just to say like what our different roles are, but it's important because there's different kind of relationships. You know, the relationship I have with parents is going to look different than a relationship that I'll have with a student or with my colleagues and that kind of thing. So we all hold different roles and different kind of sway and insight into students. Okay, so we all have different expertise, but really the parent norms are gonna be this, and this is kind of just in a nutshell. There's more, or you can make up your own if you'd like, but really your job as a parent at the high school level is to encourage your student, but don't take their responsibility. One of our main goals in high school is not only just to teach them the content of the material, but it's also to teach them how to be an adult. Okay, that's a huge part of high school. We got to teach them responsibility, managing their time, organization, follow through. All this stuff is kind of the soft skills that students learn going through high school. And that's not an easy job to teach, as I'm sure many of you have already started doing that with your sons and daughters. But that's something that we have to start. Sometimes it's hard for parents to kind of let go at times because they're so invested in kind of their future and sometimes we can actually block their future by taking it over. So that's one thing that I want to ask you guys and encourage you to do is find a way that your family works in that system and really support, but don't do. Already, begin starting to talk about life after high school. Okay, 4 years is going to go by quick, as you can probably tell. You know, it goes by super, super fast. Sometimes it feels like it's not going by fast enough, but then you get to the end and you wish you could slow it all down. Okay, so start talking about it now, because sooner or later, you're going to actually have to be making action steps and decisions with that content you're then talking about college applications, about careers they're interested in. And this is all areas that I do help with. However, I can't be the only one doing it. It's also got to be coming from home, okay? And you don't have to know everything about college applications. You don't have to know everything about careers to have that conversation. All you have to do is listen. Just ask them some questions. Somebody, you know, what about school do you like? What are the different topics about school that are interesting to you? Can you think of any careers that might be similar to that? Just having those open-ended questions and letting them express themselves. And I know freshmen, teenagers, like they're not big on talking to parents sometimes, but that's why practice is good. If you have a daughter, I always suggest dads take your daughter on a date once a month. Go out for 30 minutes, get some ice cream, and sit down and just have a talk. Talk about college, talk about career. It becomes a really cool kind of habit, and I think it really creates connections with your child. Same thing can be done with the son. Your other job is to help scholars stay on track. And again, I want to highlight help, not keep them on track, help them stay on track. I want them to be the ones that are concerned about being on track and really taking the responsibility for it. Obviously, we do not want to let them just dive off the deep end, but we do need to let them have failures and experience how that feels and how to get out of certain failures. Now, if we're talking failing English 9 and having that on your transcript forever, that's something hopefully we can like stop before it gets that far. However, if they're going to fail a test or if they're going to get a B, that is something I'm totally fine. I think the value of failing and getting that B is much greater than getting the A and not having to ever deal with that in high school. Because then they will get to college, and they will eventually fail at something, and they will not know how to do anything with it. Okay, so that's a very important concept, and it's not the easiest one to tread on. Okay, but I think it's really important that you guys start thinking about that. How will you deal with something like that as a parent? How will we deal with it at school? The student's rule, there's not any students here, so I'll kind of gloss over this. You guys can probably just read it, but start thinking about it, keeping calendars and helping them be organized. This is something that they'll be covering a lot in Pathways as well. If your student has the unfortune of being on our DNF list at the progress report, they will also be on, I will be assigning students to a mandatory, academic study skills group with me. So we will be going through a lot of this stuff together. And I'll be doing this probably two groups every single progress report for people that are on this DNF list. All it takes is one D and one F. Okay, that's to kind of hopefully stave off this progression that we see happen of people kind of consistently going down that kind of backwards slide. Deadlines are also important. I do keep fairly strict deadlines in my office. So for example, a deadline is coming up not this Friday, but the following Friday. It's called the ad drop deadline. After this Friday, the 18th, I will not process any additional ads or drops without like an emergency, like my grandma's dying, I'm having to go out of town for 3 months. What do I do? Or like my hand got chopped off, I can't do art anymore. Okay, so those are the type of emergencies that I'm talking about. Okay, it's not, I don't like my teacher, I broke up with my girlfriend and she's in the same class as me. I don't process those. That doesn't happen in real life, it's not gonna happen here. Okay, so I just wanna prep you guys that 18th, which is not this Friday, but next Friday, that's that ad drop deadline, okay? And then finally, start creating good relationships with teachers. I had my senior night last night in the morning the day before with all of our senior parents, and you know, it's nice, I get to watch them all go through the high school, and they all grew up. And I think that one big thing that they did was many of them made that good relationship with teachers. Luckily, we're in a school that's pretty easy to do. We have very supportive teachers, we have very involved teachers, but it also takes the student making the effort. And that will pay off dividends in terms of college applications, how well students like school, how invested they feel in the classes, and how well supported they feel. They don't feel lonely at school if they know a teacher cares for them. Okay, so that's very important for them to know. So encourage them to sit down. They can go talk to them at lunch. We have many teachers have their classrooms open at lunch, blasting music or hanging out or whatever they want to do. Same thing goes with office staff. Have them create a good relationship with me, with Ms. Mitchell, with Mr. Padilla. Believe it or not, Mr. Padilla's job is not just getting people in trouble. Okay, he's actually a pretty cool guy. And you know, he's there to keep people in line and keep people safe, but he's also there to help people out and make sure that they're having a good high school experience. And then finally, expectations of me. Because I am the only school counselor, I do have 365 students so far this year. We're just probably going to add another one tomorrow. I'm fairly thinly spread right now, but I do try to make sure that all students are attended to as they need to be. But it might not mean that I can always kind of drop what I'm doing to address a particular problem. I do try to make sure that everything happens timely, though. One of my goals is that every single student in this high school can meet A through G requirements. Okay, we'll go over what those A through G requirements are in just a minute. But in a nutshell, those A through G requirements are the minimum expectation that the CSU, the California State University system, and the UC, University of California system, like UC Berkeley or California State University Sacramento, have for entrance. Okay, these are a certain number of classes you have to meet with a C minus or better to be able to be even eligible to submit your applications. Okay, and my goal is to have every single one of our students be ready to meet that. Does that mean that every single student needs to go to college? No. Okay, I am one of the people that believe that college is not for everybody. Everybody should not go to college. We push constantly people into college that are, one, not ready, don't want to be there, and it's going to put them in debt, that they're going to be unhappy, and they're not going to finish. Okay, so I'm of the opinion that there are tons of different options out there from work. Some people are not mature enough. They need to go get a job first, or they need to support their family, or they need to start at a trade school or a technical school or a community college, kind of develop that academic maturity. However, I want that option to be available for all students, which is the key difference. I want every student to have that choice if they so choose to pursue that, or they're ready to pursue it. So that's one goal. I do put 100% of my professional self, and that's a key distinction. I do have a personal life as well, but I, as some of you might know, I do email occasionally in the evening from home, and I'm watching TV or whatever, and it doesn't bother me to pick up my email and email. off hours. Okay, but I typically won't like get on the phone and make phone calls after I leave work and that kind of thing. But I do promise to put 100% of my professional effort to making sure that each and every one of your kids is successful. Okay, it's gonna look different for each and every one of your kids, but everything that I got, you're gonna get. And I am constantly available to answer questions. I'm pretty good at finding resources. I have a lot of great connections around the state. I just got off the phone with Cal Poly, getting information about all their updates for their incoming class coming this next year, finding out information about new majors, all this kind of stuff. Constantly going to conferences, learning new information about college admissions, the world of school counseling. So right now I am in this like sponge mode and I love learning. So always ask me questions and I can definitely help in a lot of different areas. A few false expectations. I mean, I just want to say this, I say this lightly. It's not something that I'm like saying, don't do this, but just kind of like in a humorous manner, like, so some people think that it's my job to do X, Y, or Z for any given student. Okay. My job is to support students. It's not to do every single thing that people want me to do for them. Okay. So I will do everything I can to make sure that we meet every single need, but it might look different than maybe what a parent might be expecting to happen. Okay. So that's one thing. The other thing is that I don't work every day, all day. So I do have some quiet hours. For example, Thanksgiving break. For seniors, it's a big deal because college applications are due over Thanksgiving break. Okay, for freshmen, not so important, but I have a ton of stuff. I have weddings, I have family engagements, all kinds of stuff for Thanksgiving, so I won't be working over Thanksgiving break, just so you know. And then I have all the answers. I'm a fairly smart, bright guy, but I don't have an encyclopedic memory or knowledge of every single thing that we have. I'll probably get answers about. So if I tell you something like, you know, I'm not sure the answer, I don't know, that's probably okay. But I'll usually follow up with something like, I don't know the answer to that, but I'm going to look into it, and if you give me a couple of days, I might be able to find something good to tell you. Okay? But you might just have to be a little patient. And then I shred the slopes like Shaun White. Unfortunately, my wife does work at a ski resort, but I did not have that gene when I was born. Or the nice red hair. So, some common problems that freshmen will typically encounter. Some of you guys might have encountered this in the 8th grade as well. This kind of time frame between 8th and 10th grade is this nebulous, weird, who knows what's going on with them half the time, age range. You know, they're going through puberty or finishing up puberty. There's a lot of changes going on. Huge life changes in terms of going from middle school to high school. All those responsibilities now on them. So there's a lot of things that they're going through that's changing and uncertain in their life. So it creates a lot of stress and strife. And they don't like to let on about it, but they're usually pretty scared about a lot of things. Okay, but one big thing that they don't actually do, and this is actually a psychological concept, is that they lack consideration of future consequences. Okay, that has to do with that prefrontal cortex that's not fully developed, typically until they're almost 25, so it affects all high school students, but it's especially, you see it a lot in kind of that 9th and 10th grade year, and you see it a lot in academics. Okay, so this, really they don't think about how what they're doing now is going to impact their long-term futures, okay, for good or bad. That might mean that they don't see why studying now in their English class is going to affect their college applications. Okay, they just see as, I don't like reading, I'm not going to study, I'll study harder next year, or next semester, or next week. Okay, so that's one example. Another example might be, they're so focused on their grades that they don't understand how this stress is affecting them. People become anxious, pick up anxiety disorders because they're so stressed, they're so pressured that, you know, they can't think about how this is impacting their overall health in the long run. Okay, so there's two sides of the coin, but primarily we're seeing the easier side for students to do of not worrying anything about anything. They also avoid talking to school staff and teachers. In many cases, you might have the lucky child that's confident and able to go up and talk to people or know teachers on campus. However, that's not the normal freshman. Freshmen are usually kind of huddled in their own social group, walking around with earbuds in, running around the hallways like they're, you know, 7 years old. You can definitely tell the freshmen from the seniors sometimes, but you know, they don't really interact typically with adults very well. So that's something that we can work on together as parents and school staff of how do we open them up and have those conversations in a professional manner because they're professional students. We're professional educators. They also think of senior year, just like parents sometimes, as ages in the future. It's so far away, I can't even imagine it happening. 4 years for them is going to go even faster than 4 years for you. And they make the excuse of, well, I'm not graduating for 3.5 more years, and, you know, why does English matter to me? Why does algebra matter to me? Why does the school that I'm doing matter to me? You know, I don't want to go to college. And that lack of consideration of future consequences then plays over, and finally it clicks, maybe junior year, and they realize, oh, I see why this matters to me. They've kind of grown up a little bit, matured, but then it's too late. If they've screwed around too much in 9th and 10th grade year, they've gotten D's, F's, some C's. You know, what their options are as a senior going into college or after high school is completely different than if they really focused as a 9th grade. Okay, and they don't seek help when they need it. Okay, so students that come to high school are not always the perfect high school student. Many times they struggle in classes, they struggle socially, they struggle at home, they struggle in sports, they struggle with an injury, an illness. But they don't typically ask for help. You know, they're too afraid sometimes to ask the teacher, I don't understand this, or voluntarily go to RTI to get some extra help. And if the teacher's not, the teacher does their best to identify these kind of weaknesses and areas. However, you know, unless they're inside the child's head, they might not know their insecurities and what's going on. So when they're doing their schoolwork, having those questions come from parents of, how do you feel about this problem? How do you feel about what you're learning in class? If they, I don't know what I'm learning, well, they'll just leave it at that and say, oh, we need to go email the teacher and talk to them right away, and ask them more questions. Because that's typically the first answer everybody gets, is I don't know, I don't care. But they really know something. But really getting down to the root of the issue of, okay, what don't you know? Like, what specifically are you having trouble with? Because then that gives the you and the teacher some ammunition to work together to really target what actually the deficiency in learning is. Okay? And I skipped one, that's an important one. They actually create a lot of academic holes. What academic holes are is like that when I fail first semester of English 9, for example. We're a comprehensive high school, meaning we cannot give partial credits, and we typically don't enroll students for half-year coursework. Okay, so it gets very hard if you fail one semester and pass another to really catch up that one semester's worth of work. Typically, you're going to have to go do that independently, or most typically through Coldstream, which creates its own challenges because you can't have a full schedule and take a Coldstream course. Okay, so it really starts creating these issues. It also creates these holes in learning where many of our classes build on each other, so if you don't do well in one area, it's much harder to move on to the next. Okay. So that's an area that we hopefully can keep under control. And doing some of these things like 1 to 2, there's a handout over here about it, and I'll talk briefly about what that actually means, will be really helpful. All right, any questions so far? We're gonna kind of jump a little bit into some kind of college prep coursework and talking more about how do we work through some of these high school different programs we're gonna be looking at, as well as kind of what colleges are looking for in terms of classes that you might be wanting to take as a high school student. Any questions at all? Yeah.
I apologize, I have to leave early.
No worries. Yes.
Oh, excellent. Thank you.
Yeah, by the way, I do record all my events, at least one of them. If I have two, I just record one, like I'm recording this right now. I do put it on YouTube, on the school's YouTube page, so if you're unable to make an event, I do highly suggest coming if you're able to. Don't just say, oh, he's going to record it. Sometimes the thing messes up. It's always nice to get the handouts, to be able to ask questions, that kind of thing. But if you're not able to, or if you want your child to watch it, the nice thing is you can fast forward, you can pause, you can come back to it later, and that kind of thing. Yeah.
Could you explain a little more of what RTI is for?
Sure. So RTI, that's a period of students' day, and it happens on typically the Wednesday and Thursday of our block days. Okay, and it's always in the morning from 7:30 to about 8:15. And what it stands for is Response to Intervention. It's actually RTI squared. I don't even know what the second I is. I forget. But it's Response to Intervention. And what that is it's a time when teachers can identify students who are maybe struggling, maybe need some reteaching, or possibly missed tests, missed assignments, that kind of thing. And they can either require it mandatorily that the student attends their RTI session in the morning for biology or English or whatever it might be. Or students can voluntarily go in and say, hey, I'm not understanding this concept. And it gives teachers a time to do some reteaching where it's outside of the classroom setting. So RTI is built like a pyramid. Okay, so if you envision a pyramid, there's three sections of the pyramid. Okay, This section, RTI section, I believe, is section number two. So it's you know, I think it's 70% of students or 80% of students are going to get everything they need in the classroom. That's the bottom kind of pyramid tier. Okay, the next tier is that that RTI intervention time in the morning, where okay, there's about 15% of students that then didn't get all they needed in the classroom. Maybe they had some holes in learning. Maybe they missed a lot of school. Okay, there's that 15% of students that need that extra kind of oomph to get the content down. That's the RTI period. Above that is even a greater tool that really is kind of like after school tutoring. It's one-on-one check-ins with you know, me or Ms. Padilla, Mr. or Ms. Mitchell. That typically will come into play after our first progress report. We have a DNF list, and those are our tier three highest kind of warning lights students. And we kind of pull out all kinds of different stops to make sure that they're getting what they need to get done.
So if the student feels like they need help in Spanish, for instance, they could just walk into that classroom during that period and get help?
Hypothetically, yes. So teachers are required to have one day when they have their classroom open. That doesn't have to be both days. So he could talk, and most of the time the teachers will tell the students in the classes of what time they can come in during RTI. But hypothetically, yes, he can come in and ask for help. There might be other students in the class at the same time, so he might not get immediate help, but he can get some support, and it's a quiet place to work. So yes, there's support, reteaching that goes on. It's always helpful, too, if they have a group of students that's maybe in the same spot or maybe miss the same day, if they all kind of come in together, because then the teachers can address it as a group instead of individual meetings. But that's kind of what the design of that period is for, to kind of get that extra level of support and teaching. Good question. Any other questions so far? All right. So let's talk really A through G requirements. And this
Mr. Ream?
Yes.
I'm sorry. Can you explain a block day?
Yes, block day. So yeah, we are on, so our schedule, just kind of give you guys a brief overview. Our schedule, our weekly schedule, is on what's called the modified block system. Okay. Not to be confused with what Truckee has, which is a 4x4 block, which is kind of the standard block system, where students take one set of classes and then in January they switch to another set. Students have all six classes, or however many they have, all year long here. They don't change at the semester break. However, we used to be on that, and we went away with it and kind of capitalized, I think, the benefits of both systems. A full day where you have all six periods, plus the benefits of the block. So the block schedule is where, for example, on Wednesday this week, they had periods 1, 3, and 5. So they don't go to 2, 4, and 6 on this day. They go the next day to those periods. That's been also their RTI period in Pathways, which is an advisory type curriculum, grade level, where they all have the same grade in the class, and they get delivered a bunch of information about college, career, how to be successful in high school, community service happens in there, a lot of different things goes on. It's a short period, but you also do SSR at that time.
And SSR is?
Sustained Silent Reading. Sorry, if I do that, I use a lot of acronyms because that's what I'm used to. Uh-huh. Stop me and ask that exact question. I might not know all the acronym descriptions, but I sometimes ignore that you guys may not know what certain acronyms mean. So they do read for about 25 minutes once a day, or once a week, all together as a school, and then the other day is that pathway advisory. But that block schedule really gives the teachers an opportunity to do more project-based kind of learning, as well as larger assessments, larger group work together with students, where it's I think it's an hour and a half, hour and something minute, you know. So a much longer chunk of time, yeah.
Okay.
So yeah, so they're not just going to like three periods and then hanging out in the quad all day. The periods are extended to fill the rest of the time.
Thank
and then there are other times they have the six period, kind of 48 minute standard classes.
Okay, thanks.
Good question, any other questions? I'm anticipating a lot of questions tonight, guys. I know freshmen and I know freshman parents, so don't be afraid to ask questions. No question is a stupid question in my book. Only the one not answered. Answered to, but, yeah.
CSU UC is 2 years, I thought it was 3 years.
So we'll get there.
Okay.
We'll go through them all. So this is a piece of paper I created this year. We used to have this old, ugly kind of Excel spreadsheet that kind of was not easy to use. So I put this together. Hopefully it's a little bit easier to look at and read, but each column is a different kind of system. And if you might not have noticed, the two-year college and the high school graduation is the same. That's on purpose. There's no extra work that you need to do to get into a community college, but I wanted to include it in kind of the systems you can prepare for. Okay. The biggest thing about community college is I would highly recommend taking math as many years as you can, because you will take placement tests into a math class for community college purposes. Okay. Okay, so this is kind of the brief overview. We'll go through each of the different areas here and cover what that looks like and how many years and that kind of thing. But I just wanted you to see this, and that's kind of what we're going to be kind of working through. So you can make notes on there, and then students will also get this when I meet with them as well. All right, so these are all the A through G requirements. Okay, there are more classes that we have than fall into these A through G requirements. These are strictly your college entrance requirements. I will touch on some of the other requirements that we have for graduation as well, but I'll start with these. Because again, my goal is that 100% of students meet these requirements. Whether they want to go to college or not, they should have the choice to do that. So history is the first one. That's going to be your A, and there's A through G categories, if you didn't pick up on that. They're going to need 2 years of history. Our graduation requirement is 3 years, so we actually exceed this. The only difference is, for all of these A through G courses, you must get a C minus or better for it to qualify. If you get a D in an A through G course, that semester or that year, that however many semesters you get that D in, no longer fills that requirement. However, for graduation purposes, and I do not agree with this, but I'm not the boss, D's get degrees at high school. Okay, so kind of like some of the colleges, if you get a D in English, you will graduate high school. Okay, so D minus and above, you will graduate with a diploma. Okay, however, if you get a D in English and meet all of the other A through G requirements and do not repeat that D, you will not be eligible to apply to a CSU or a UC. Okay, so I want to make sure that's clear, the C and the D difference. Question in the back.
So the repeat is necessary or not necessary?
Necessary. It's necessary if you get a D. It's necessary if you want to go to apply to college. If you want to graduate, it's not necessary. If you get an F, you definitely have to repeat it no matter what, if it's part of that high school graduation requirements. And these fairly mirror what we have for high school graduation requirements. And I'll denote when they don't. So like I said, for history, we require 3 years of history where they only denote two. So all of our students, as long as they're passing a C's or better, will meet this requirement because we require it for them to graduate. For example, all 10th graders will take world history, all 11th graders will take AP US history or US history, and all seniors will take AP government or government. Econ is actually titled with that class, but that's not technically a history course. It counts for a history requirement for graduation though. And another acronym that I'll define, AP stands for Advanced Placement. You might have heard the College Board maybe in the past, they're the people that do the SATs, the PSATs, all the big entrance tests for college. They also run the Advanced Placement AP program. And what that is, that's a college level course taught at a high school. Okay, it's not college credit, but at the end of each year, in May, students can elect to take a test, a big capstone cumulative test that they can then, if they pass it, typically it's scored out of 5, they usually get a 3, 4, or 5 on that exam. They will then be able to report that score to the college they end up with and typically be awarded credits at the college level for taking that test and receiving that score. So if students take 4, 5, 6 AP test or AP classes and take the tests that go along with it and pass, they can go to college with 15, 20 units sometimes. Many times things like the English class is super huge for helping students be successful and like skip over that freshman level, entry level English class at college. Most of the time, I would say almost 95% of the time or greater, you will not see an AP class until you hit your junior year. Very, very specific instances when a sophomore is able to take an AP course. So typically, you're going to have several years before you get there. Those honors level English classes that you guys are, possibly some of you guys might be in, those are what I would call, we can't call it this because it's copyrighted, but it's not honors, but it's really kind of pre-AP is what you're considering. It's really to prep you for some kind of going into these AP level coursework. Okay? Do you have a question?
Are the AP tests administered at school?
Yes, so AP tests are administered at school. They're always typically the first 2 weeks of May. They have specific dates and time. We'll kind of jump into all that kind of logistics when we start talking junior year properly. We don't have to, there's much more important things to worry about right now. Let's get to AP classes. That's my goal. So that's history. So B is English. English is very easy. You need 4 years at college, you need 4 years to graduate. Okay, so it's fairly simple. You basically, if you get an F, you got to repeat it no matter what. If you get a D and you want to go meet these A through G requirements, you go to 4 year college. And those are fairly similar anywhere you want, that's not just the state systems in California. D's typically are not acceptable for 4 year colleges. Okay, you'd have to repeat that if you got a D for the college purpose, okay? And again, there's all the different non-honors in AP, and then also the AP and honors track. And students can go back and forth. We do not have limited AP or honors access. We do kind of counsel students one way or the other, depending on what teachers suggest and how you know their history has been. But if a student's very well motivated, they've changed a lot between, you know, they've got a C in English 9 or English 10 maybe, and really want to do the AP English 11 class, we're going to talk to them and we're going to see what why they think that and kind of what they have to back it up. You know, we're not going to say no. We're going to try to definitely, you know, kind of uncover what all the whole story is. But, you know, we don't limit access other than space to, or if you fail the class, to AP coursework. Okay, just so you know, it's open enrollment as long as there's space in the class. So math, and this is where it kind of gets a little bit complicated. So math is a C category. Students are going to need 3 years of math. However, when you're talking about 3 years of math, they're talking about 3 years of high school math. Okay, and what high school math means is Algebra 1 or Integrated Math 1, Integrated Math 2 or Geometry, Integrated Math 3 or Algebra 2. That is considered 3 years of high school math. Okay, however, there is a very strong recommendation that students pursue all 4 years of math every year they're in high school. Okay, so even though they might have met this requirement, maybe as a sophomore, or even sometimes as a freshman in odd cases, they still should pursue math as far as they can at the high school level. It really shows, colleges really focus on the math and science, because that's really the areas that students have to kind of expand their options. They all got to take English, they all got to take history. You know, that's really where they have some options of stepping up their game and really making things happen. Okay? I'm not going to get into the intricacies of something called validation, but just know that there are certain rules with math at the UC and CSU level that not necessarily a D in geometry, for example, will ruin your chances as long as you pursue higher level. It's much more complicated than that, but I'll just tell you, like, if you guys have circumstances where you get into a pickle with a grade in math, it's not the end of the world at that point. We have to do some investigation and see kind of what our different options are. However, there are different rules in place that kind of address it. However, starting, I believe it's this fall, it might have been last, I think it's this fall, I have to check my dates. This fall, students cannot omit geometry integrated math too, okay, meaning that has to be included on their transfer. For students coming in on Algebra 2 or Integrated Math 2 as a freshman, there's very few of them, we will add that to their transcript as a X'd out class, just showing it in their eighth grade year. That's the only students that we do that for because of this requirement from the UC saying that geometry cannot be omitted. You have to take that class at the high school level or Integrated Math 2. I got to start using this new lingo. I'm not used to it yet either. But those are our math classes. We are going to that Integrated Math pathway. Next year will be our last year with any of the algebra, geometry, algebra 2 pathway. It'll be the entire integrated math approach. And just so you know, there is some conversation about pre-calculus. Right now, the expectation is pre-calculus will still be part of the curriculum and part of the path. Until we hear anything different from math teachers, our math PLC, our district office, state level people, there's no expectation that pre-calculus people will go from integrated math 3 to calculus. Just so you guys know, and that might not even have been on your radar, but it's on ours. Any questions about math? Because that's usually one people have some questions about. So there's several different ways of going about math. No? All right. Laboratory science, and I think it's very important to denote laboratory. Okay. Laboratory science is a requirement that you must have 2 years of a lab science, 1 year must be a physical, and 1 year must be a life science. Very similarly, our graduation requirements require, oh, let me back up 1 second. Before I forget to talk about graduation requirements for math. So math graduation requirements very much mirror this. We require 30 credits, and there's 10 credits per year, 5 credits per semester for each class that you're in, except for things like pathways, which is 1 credit. But with math, you're required to have 30 credits by the time you graduate, and that starts from the time you start high school. Algebra from middle school does not count. Nothing from the middle school follows you over. Okay, so it's going to be 30 high school math credits. And 2 of those math credits have to be, you have to basically get through the level of integrated math 2 or higher. Okay, so students have to pass Integrated Math 1 or Algebra 1 and Geometry Integrated Math 2 plus one more. That could be things like we have a business math class, which is not a college prep class. It's not going to show up here, but it's still a very good class that students maybe not geared towards a four-year college might want to take, or students possibly interested in just kind of pursuing the information that's talking about like taxes and budgeting and that kind of thing. Okay, that's one pathway. Most students that go through our system that are kind of progressing through the math pathway, they're going to either start in Integrated 1, 2, and go through 3, and then onward, or they'll start in 2, do 3, and then go to pre-calculus, and then that will meet their requirement for graduation. Did you have a question?
Yes, trigonometry in there somewhere?
Trigonometry is split between Integrated Math and pre-calculus. So it's embedded in the two courses. It's kind of split. That's one talk about the pre-calculus class that might happen. They might actually make it a full-on trig class and do away with kind of the pre-calculus label. It's really just in the, like the name.
Yeah.
It's all covered. They don't miss trigonometry. But it's just in different places.
Kim, sorry, can you go back to, so if there's a freshman that's in Integrated Math 2 this year, how does that set up the...
So Integrated Math 2, so for students starting in Integrated Math 2 this year, for graduation purposes, they will need to complete Integrated Math 2, Integrated Math 3, plus one more. So that could be pre-calculus, that could be statistics online, that could be business math.
Okay.
Okay.
But for college purposes, the business math and the statistics wouldn't count.
Statistics would.
Okay.
Business math would not.
Okay.
For these college entrance requirements,
mm-hmm.
the UC system maintains a list of approved courses.
Okay.
For that, and if you have any students that are taking outside credits through BYU or anything online or through other places, that is one big requirement that we do have. All of our outside courses that we approve for our credit must be A through G approved.
Okay.
So that's one. They have a big list that all the high schools in California maintain. We have one. Truckee has one. Any high school you can look up. And most many online programs maintain as well. Those are courses that get reviewed by the UC system, and they're kept and updated yearly.
Okay.
That answer your question?
Okay, so Integrated Math 2 this year, Algebra
Integrated Math 3 next year.
Next year.
Then pre-calculus, business math, statistics.
Any one of those.
Yep.
Okay.
But you know, if you're going to be doing four, you're probably going to want to do one, two, three pre-calculus,
calculus
and most likely.
Okay.
Yeah. Any other questions?
I have a stupid question.
No stupid questions. You missed that part.
Once they're in honor English, they take a test every year to be in honors English. So
no.
Once they're in.
They can be, unless they're like grievously failing.
Okay.
Then we have a conversation, and we kind of either try to counsel you out of it, or we talk about it and have a come Jesus moment and say, hey, this is what's going on. Okay, so we have an open enrollment policy. Even the test at the eighth grade, if you really want your kid in honors English, we're not going to tell you no.
Okay.
We're just going to say, hey, you know what? All of our information from the experts is saying you're not ready for this. If you want to push your kid in there, that's fine with us. Just don't be surprised if they don't do as well as you're hoping. You know, we'll do everything we can to support them, but, you know, all the data we have is showing that it might not be the best fit. So yeah, we don't test them in between, but we do look at where they're at, how they're progressing, and if it's the best kind of route that they should go each year.
Okay.
But we're not going to say, oh, you're out.
Right.
You know, kick you out. Any other questions before I jump over here? So going back to science. Wake up. All right. Very similar to high school graduation here. For graduation, you need 1 year of a lab science and 1 year of physical science. Very similar to this. However, here, colleges are highly recommending 3, but it's a very good idea to have 4 years of lab science. Okay? Almost all freshmen, if not all freshmen, are taking biology this year. Nearly all sophomores are going to take chemistry next year. A couple different reasons for it. One, because when they go through with their peer group, they're much more successful. Two, it gets both of these requirements, high school and college requirements, met, or we can identify where they're struggling the most so we can figure out how to meet that the following year. And also, it's kind of it's a great stepping stone into that AP world because AP sciences are extremely challenging. They're college-level courses taught at a high school campus, essentially. Okay, the curriculum is vetted by university professors, faculty, and gone through with a fine-tooth comb. It gets approved just like the UCs, but even more in depth every year, I believe. Highly suggest you guys take 4 years of science. Obviously, the third and fourth year are definitely optional. If you guys have other plans or other routes you want to take, that's up for discussion, but it's definitely something that I think would be fairly helpful to any application that you're thinking about submitting at the four-year level. talking about community college, if you're thinking about that, meet that 2 years again. Community college, you got to graduate. Okay, that doesn't mean you get to like slack off, but it's much. You don't have to take quite as many recommended courses to be eligible. As long as you graduate, you're eligible to apply, to enroll at a community college. Our classes fluctuate by year, just so you know, based on interest and staffing and how many different classes we need to be able to offer in different areas. Okay, so this year and last year, we've been lucky enough to offer all of our different AP sciences that we have available, which are up there, for biology, AP biochemistry, AP physics, physics, AP environmental science, anatomy, physiology. All those are offered this year. The likelihood of those being offered every single year is up in the air, because we don't know if we'll need an extra bio class because the ninth grade is big. If a teacher moves or, you know, says I want to only work 3 days, you know, work three classes instead of six, you know, we have to adjust that with our schedule, and we might not have a teacher to teach that subject any longer. Okay, but we try to offer as many as we can. Any questions about science? Yes?
E-science is only AP?
Yes. So certain classes are only AP options. Most of them have both, but environmental science is one of those. Anatomy physiology is one that doesn't have an AP option. There's also a physical science class that meets graduation, a general physical science class that meets the graduation requirements, but is not a college prep course. Typically, we will assign students that if they took chemistry, we always assign students chemistry first. We want to give them the college prep class and see how they do. If they struggle in chemistry or don't pass chemistry many times, we'll talk about either trying a different one, but more likely we'll talk to them about taking this physical science class, which is general. It's not quite as intense as a chemistry course. It's been more of an overview, kind of a survey of kind of physical sciences. Question?
So you only have AP biology, or do you have...
No, we have all freshmen are in biology right now.
And there's no AP.
And it's not all AP biology.
No. So if we go back, these little brackets mean that there's a bio and an AP bio class.
Oh, okay.
For example, AP Environmental Science, there's only an AP Environmental Science. There is an AP Chemistry class. I forgot to add that up there. When I edited it, I might have, because we didn't have it available last year, I don't think, or something. But yes, there is an AP Chemistry course. Just a note about the sciences when we get there. Physics is a class that you can jump into physics or AP Physics. You don't have to take physics first. However, chemistry, you do have to take chemistry before you can take AP. Side note about that. Any other questions about science? All right.
I have one.
Okay.
So there is, right now, there's like an AP biology class going and just a biology?
Yes.
Not for ninth grade.
Not for ninth grade. Correct.
Okay.
So all ninth graders are going to take that that standard biology class.
Okay.
When they get older, typically after that chemistry class, then they can go back into that AP bio class, AP environmental science, AP physics, AP chem. They have all that kind of slew of options available to them.
So what's the normal pattern of...
So the typical suggested pathway that I usually suggest for most students, and every student's going to be a little bit different depending on what their interests and strengths are, but in general, biology, chemistry, physics, or an AP science, physics or an AP science in 12th grade and 11th grade. So it kind of branches out in 11th and 12th. Unless I have very good reasoning, I'm going to basically, like I did with this year, I'm basically assigning all sophomores chemistry. For next year, unless I have really good conversations with parents and like a really strong reasoning why I shouldn't, because that's what we've seen be most successful for all students. Any other questions? All right. So you'll see LOAT, language other than English. Fortunately or unfortunately, depending on your point of view, we only offer Spanish at our school, mainly because of our school size. We did just hire a French person, someone who can teach French through Coldstream this year. So if your student is interested possibly in pursuing French in the coming years, that's something that's a possibility. I know that right now they don't have any availability for French through Coldstream because she also teaches math, and they are prioritizing her being available for math this year because of much more demand for it, and she has limited time. She's teaching classes in Truckee as well. However, with the language, students can also take certain language online. Once you get to the higher level languages, typically past level 2 or 3, any online language, if you're seeking out Arabic or Japanese or whatever you want to do, it becomes almost impossible to find a higher level language independently online. And I also suggest language is going to be incredibly difficult to learn by yourself. That's why most students, we really kind of suggest the Spanish. Not only that, it's the most applicable language for where we live, and pretty much unless you're planning on living in Japan, you're only going to speak that like anime conventions or something like that. So for high school graduation, this is kind of where our graduation and college entrance requirements kind of split a little bit. Our graduation requirements says that a student needs a fine art or a foreign language, 1 year, 10 credits of either, okay, for graduation. However, college is much different. So they're going to need both language and a fine art separately for college entrance requirements. Okay, and that's one reason why we have students taking their CTE sometimes as a freshman, their science, their English, their math, their language, and possibly an art if we can fit it in, plus PE. Like, there's a lot of different options, but let me get through here, and that might answer your question. I might think about what you're already asking. But you need 2 years minimum for college entrance of the same language. So it can't be Arabic one and Japanese one. It can't be Spanish one and French one. It's got to be 2 years of the same language in sequence. The third year is highly recommended by schools. Anything beyond that is kind of icing on the cake. One of the questions that we typically get if my student is a dual immersion student, what do we do and how does that count? Okay, students that come in Spanish for Spanish speakers 3, that is a third level Spanish course. Okay, by completing Spanish for Spanish speakers 3, you're technically completing that third level class. Math and English do what's called validation again. And that also says here, if you complete a higher level of math or a higher level of language, that tells me that you know all the other stuff below it. With the exception of math and geometry. So same thing with that Spanish 3 for Spanish speakers course. By completing that class, it tells you, you already know the content from level 1 and 2. You're at that level 3. However, in my opinion, it does not give you the excuse to stop studying Spanish. Your check mark is complete. However, colleges also consider things like continuity of their classes, how rigorous their schedule is. Okay, so they want to see you pursuing not just the bare minimum, that's not the bare minimum, that's actually kind of the recommended number, but the bare minimum of classes you have to take to meet that in high school. By taking one class in Spanish in high school, it doesn't show a lot of great tenacity in pursuit of excellence in your, you know, fields and that kind of thing. Okay, so I saw a couple of hands.
What if your child struggles in Spanish and will it hurt? I mean, you get your 2 years done, but it's going to be the lowest grade out of that class, and I mean, he could be taking an AP, something
right.
else, the third year.
One thing that I'll tell you about college admissions and kind of that world that you know people kind of have their head in and that I live in quite a bit of the year, is that it's a gray area. There's no black and whites really with college admissions, other than you met this or you didn't. When you start talking about, well, what if I don't take AP Calculus but I take AP Chemistry, right? You know, I struggled with Spanish 2. Should I take Spanish 3 and try, you know, maybe get an F or take a different class? That's all kind of gray area. And my biggest response to that is it depends on what you're going to replace it with and how successful you think you'll be, plus what you think you're going to probably pursue in college. If you're going to be a linguist, you probably don't want to drop Spanish. But if you're like, you know, you're going to be an engineer, you don't necessarily have to have Spanish if you could possibly take like a science class instead. They're going to obviously look probably more favorably on that science class rather than struggling through a third level Spanish course. Does that answer the question a little bit? Okay, I'm sorry, some of those questions are kind of like, I don't have solid answers, but I'll try to do my best to give you a picture of what it looks like. Okay. And it'll be different probably in every circumstance a little bit. Did you have a question? What's your name? Who's your child?
Antonio.
Tony Frankenberg.
Okay. I'm trying to learn parents and kids. And
this is probably another gray matter question, but if a kid does bad in a class, would it be better to retake the class and get a better grade, or would it be better to just move on?
So yeah, definitely gray area. Depends on what class it is, depends on what the grade is, depends on how strong they are in that class, depends on where they are in their kind of sequence, what other classes they're taking, a lot of variables. So it would really depend a lot on what all those things kind of line up as. I can tell you right now, our district policy is still kind of in the revision process, but currently the way our repeat policy is, grades don't disappear. So the grade, no matter what grade you get, and this is not going to change in the future either, the grade that you get will never disappear from any class. If you get an F in English 9, you're going to have an F in English 9 on your transcripts forever. That doesn't go away. However, students can then repeat the course, and typically we are also going to be probably limiting what classes can be repeated. Typically only classes with D's or F's will be able to be repeated for a replaced grade pseudo. It'll show a new grade on there. However, with those D's and F's, it will replace the impact on your GPA. So there's still some decisions being made at the district office. I don't have the exact kind of language that's going to be a repeat policy, but in most circumstances, it really is going to depend on how well or what the impact was of why they didn't pass the class. Do they have the content knowledge that they didn't turn in their homework? I mean, that's one big question that I would say. It's probably better that you just move on and complete the next class, as long as it's not required that you have to repeat it and show mastery in the next level. Okay? Or is it, I have no idea what I even, you know, como te llamas is, and I'm going to be in Spanish 3 now, and, you know, I don't have any content understanding. You should definitely probably repeat that course. So that's probably the biggest thing that we would look at is how much they know and what their reason for having that kind of lower grade would be. We don't ever replace grades. One, because it does impact college, and we have to be able to access that grade when we're applying. Colleges also don't accept repeat grades. So they have to be able to report that grade honestly on a college application, no matter what that is. They do have ways to show that it was repeated, and colleges take that into account. However, are we going to report everything that happened accurately as they went through kind of their educational timeline, because that's the story of their high school experience. Any other questions? Did that answer the question as best I could?
As best you could.
Okay. Yeah. It's just not very clear. There's not a.
I figured it would be a great matter.
Any other questions about language, Spanish, anything else on this slide? We're almost done with this part. So F, VPA or Visual Performing Arts, sometimes called VAPA, as well. So this is going to be you're going to need 1 year of the same Visual Performing Art. Okay, that's it. There's not a really recommended number of this visual performing art requirement. That is, unless you're going into being a performance major or something like that with music or artist and that kind of thing, going through an art degree. Obviously, you're going to want to pursue as many of those courses as you can if that's going to be your focus. But the visual performing arts is anything within kind of the visual, the art, ceramics, photography courses, symphonic band, wind ensemble, jazz band if you take it for credit. And jazz ensemble. If you've taken a jazz band class for no credit, it does not count. Only 4-credit classes and graded classes count for college admissions. Pass no pass classes will not count for anything. But that's, you just need 1 year of that. And the same thing, again, for graduation purposes, fine art or foreign language, 1 year of either for graduation. Any questions about where we're at so far? We have one more category left, and it's pretty easy. So CPE or college prep elective. Essentially what that is, you need 1 year of a CPE, and this is the easiest one to complete because it's essentially one extra year of any of the other requirements or any of these classes down here, and every single student's going to take 1 year of economics, or one semester of economics. So really you need one semester of another class to complete this requirement. You can take any of those other classes. That might mean, say pre-calculus, calculus will count towards this. Third or fourth year science will count towards this. Physical science, AP psychology is one of those. AP psychology is not a lab science. It's going to be a kind of a. Your husband's not going to like me because I'm filling his classes full. So all those classes will fill that up. So that in a nutshell is A through G. Okay, I want you guys just to have a brief understanding of it. I know we went through it kind of in depth, but it's good because you guys need to kind of know this as we're looking at classes for next year. Going forward, we do start all students on an A through G pathway, just so you know. So none of your students are not following this. The big thing when they get off this pathway is when they do possibly get a D or an F in classes. That's where we kind of get off track. And those are the big holes that I was talking about earlier, where we kind of make oopsies and it gets harder and harder to fill. Sooner or later, it becomes impossible to fill while staying at this high school. Okay? Let's see what the next part is. I forget. All right, so some overview. And I did meet with your freshmen this morning, and I went through some of this with them, because they need to know what their jobs are. And so essentially, their number one job, and it should be their only job, and I want to highlight because many times students in particular, but sometimes parents as well, their job is here to be at school learning and being a student. Okay, that's their only job. Unless you're like supporting your family at home and working, and that's the only way you're going to have food on the table. Obviously, you know, your kind of livelihood needs are going to come before other things if you can't afford food. But other than that, your job is to be a good student, to study, to get good grades, to learn. Okay? Where that kind of gets some confusion is when we have the term student athlete. Okay? We love athletics at the high school. We love students being involved in athletics. However, many times the idea becomes athlete-student, okay? And that is completely backwards. The student is here to become an athlete. We love to support their athletics and their pursuit of what they are very enjoyable, and what parents like to go watch and support, and what we like to you know, hear the scores on and go visit the games, that kind of thing too. However, if a student is not completing their first job, their second job is not gonna come either. We have what's called academic ineligibility. And that basically means any student with a 2.0 or less and one F or more, and there's a few other ways to get on the academic ineligibility list, which also includes pathways. So if students do not complete their community service requirement, which we'll talk about, they will also become ineligible for sports. And the ineligibility, I don't have all the specifics because I'm not super embedded in the athletic stuff, but it does last a period of time from like a progress report until some other time later. There's a set period of time when students are ineligible for, and there's nothing that we can do about it to make them eligible. So if you want your student to play, make sure they're taking care of their number one job, that's being a student, okay? Attendance is also fairly important. If a student misses school, I believe the day before a game or something like that, or the day of the game, they are no longer eligible to play in that game, unless there's certain ways around it. But you can talk to Mr. Padilla about those specific rules if you have questions, but I'm pretty sure that's another requirement. Is attendance on the day of games. You can't, you know, be gone and then come and play a game. There might be excuses for like a doctor's appointment or something like that. But if you have questions about any of that, or you think you might miss a day of a game, touch base with Mr. Padilla. He's our assistant principal, and Laura Delore is also our athletic director. They're gonna have more information about the specifics regarding athletics and eligibility and that kind of thing. But I wanted to cover like the importance that we put on being a student at North Tahoe High School and how much we value athletics, but how much more we value their learning. Yeah.
So what happens on the day where they have to miss school, like on Friday for a football game? What happens to that attendance?
So it's a function.
The entire team is leaving.
Right. So they're morning. Excused. It's a school function. So it's not. It doesn't impact their attendance. So if they're leaving for a football game, you know, they're excused from kind of like our attendance, you know, kind of tracking and consequences of that and having too many absences and that kind of thing. However, they are not excused from work typically. So they are still responsible for maintaining their work, being responsible and working with their teachers and getting information ahead and following up on anything they missed.
So obviously they are missing the school, but
yeah.
It doesn't count as absent.
Correct.
Okay.
So it's coded, they'll say absent, you won't get any phone calls or anything, but they'll say, we code it as an F, which is a school function, instead of like an A or a U, which is absence or unexcused absence.
Mm-hmm.
So it won't have any negative impact in terms of attendance. So one thing that's super important, I kind of covered it briefly, and I'll cover it briefly one more time, is grades matter, but learning content is more important. Okay? Some people are so embedded in this idea of grades and getting an A that they don't actually learn anything. They just know how to complete forms and check boxes. And nowhere in life, maybe except for maybe like the DMV, is that what you do for a living. You know, you might do some of that, but if you do not know how to, you know, do basic addition, write a decent memo or an email, have conversations with people, trying to think of another example where, have critical thinking skills. You're not going to be successful in college. You're not going to be successful as successful in a career. Okay, so the key piece that I want students to learn is that you're not gonna, if you get a B, but you put 150% of your effort in, I'm totally okay with a B. I'm completely fine with a B if you tried everything you could to understand and you learned as much as you could. However, I'm not okay with a B if you gave 50% and if you slacked off. Okay, that's not an excuse in my book. So I'm more focused, not so much on the grades to a certain level. We start getting into the DF category, then we have a little more conversation. But we're looking at the A, B, even C range. I'm more focused on how much impact and effort they're putting into the class and targeted work and really like energy is going into it. The student is trying their best and they're using every resource available to them and they still get a B or C, you know, obviously it's just maybe a challenging subject for them. C's are okay. C's do not mean that you're a terrible student. It just means that maybe this is a little bit harder for you and it's easier for someone else. I'm sure there's other areas that maybe that student is, if they're an A and another student's a C, it might be football, it might be baseball. Other students are not great at sports or PE. Okay, so there's different areas that students have strength, and it's going to take students different amount of energy and effort and understanding to be successful at one or the other. But not everyone's going to get those A's just because they tried hard. They need to actually learn the content and focus on that piece. It also helps because the grades actually, and the classes actually are sequential in many cases. You know, that biology class, it's going to have some playover into chemistry. That English class is definitely going to grow into English 10 and English 11. Math is obviously going to grow. So if you just check off the boxes but you didn't learn anything in Integrated Math 1, Integrated Math 2 is going to be incredibly difficult. You might remember some of it, but it's going to be a very big challenge.
Do the kids get any kind of, I would say, I guess, grade help for effort?
So, no.
So all the effort in the world doesn't matter if they're getting a D, they get a D, or if they're getting a C.
Correct. So we used to have what's called a work ethic grade, and I think most of the teachers have done away with that. I could be wrong. But we are kind of moving towards and really kind of embracing what's called like a mastery approach to grading, I believe. And what that is students have multiple opportunities to show that they understand material. Okay, there's a concept of turning in work and getting graded for work completion. There's also the idea of getting graded and being able to show that you actually know the material, maybe in a different way. So a student might not necessarily know the test material, but if they can prove that they know the content that test was covering through, say, a report or an online presentation or something like that, they have to work with the teacher, obviously. The teacher is the one that actually ultimately controls the grades. They have complete legal control. We can't even go in and change it. But they're the ones that would be able to make that determination of how students can show mastery in a different way. Does that make sense? So there is not a work ethic at most classes, at least anymore, that I know of or seen in the last year or two.
Is the school going to continue with our older child? It was always they have the opportunity to improve. If they blew an assignment.
Typically. So yes, and yes within reason. That'll be my answer. Yes, within reason. So we want to give students opportunities. We don't think because you blew it one time should you be penalized forever. However, you know, you can't
blow them all.
Yeah, you can't blow them all and expect to get an A or be able to take all the tests at the very end of the year, be able to turn in every single piece of assignment in June. So I mean, there's within reason. So many teachers have set up a system where, you know, you have, if you bond this test, you have the opportunity to retake it, and they might not give you full credit for that test. You know, they might penalize you, you know, you can maybe only get an 80% or something like that, but you have until the next exam that's scheduled to repeat and take that test again. So they might set up certain systems, and that's going to be different based on each teacher. So every classroom is going to look a little bit different in terms of what their individual class policies are. However, we do have a whole school rubric and grading policy in terms of what the grading system is. But the assignments and their policies in terms of how students complete assignments and what their policies for makeups and retakes and that kind of thing is a teacher-by-teacher basis. Did that answer the question? Okay.
My name is...
Well,
okay. I'll kind of skip through some of this. Second job that they have is to get involved. So getting involved in sports, getting involved in a club, getting involved in their community service activities, which I will promise I will cover because it's always a question. But that is a huge thing that students don't think about. Schools and colleges and even employers love to see students who are involved in their community more than what they're just being told that they have to do for a grade or for graduation. They want to see students who are giving back, who are involved. It also is a great way to get ideas about what kind of careers and what kind of experiences they actually enjoy. You know, students that maybe would have had no idea that they'd like to be a vet, went and volunteered at a community society, and then fell in love with that career field and are possibly going to vet school because of it. So, I mean, there's different things that students can have experiences in, and it's also super impacting on their applications because colleges want to see that piece. We're not going to talk too much about like college admissions, like the actual process and what they're looking for overall. But many colleges are doing what's called a holistic kind of view of students, where they're not just looking at GPA, grades, classes, looking at essays. They're looking at how well you write. Some schools do interviews. They're looking at community service, leadership opportunities. All these different things have small impacts on your applications. So these things are super important. So if they get involved, they also have a much more enjoyable high school experience. They have more connections. They feel more at home at school. They have other fun things because not all students love to go to class. But they find other things like clubs. You know, they have a drama club. They put on their own plays. They write their own plays, and they really like that kind of stuff. So it's a great opportunity for kids to get excited about something maybe other than math. All right, so a few to-dos. We'll kind of skip through some of this because it's mainly stuff I go over with students, but I want you guys to just be aware. So we will be working with all freshmen to get on a program called Naviance.
Sorry.
It's
at the elementary school.
All students will get on a program called Naviance. It'll probably happen between the next 2 to 4 or 5 weeks. It takes us a little bit of time to get through and get everyone on there, but just know they will. And we always go through an interest inventory with them at that same time. So they'll have an interest inventory, kind of get some ideas of what the computer thinks they might like. That's a starting point for what they might want to dig into and do some more research. Another thing that's really important too, and we will work with them throughout the year, is doing a learning style inventory. So students learn in different ways, whether it's kinesthetic, visual, auditory. There's different ways that students absorb and like take in information and knowledge. And most people can do it all three ways, but usually have a way that's the strongest and the best way to do it. And if you identify that, it can help you know, okay, well, I know that this day we're going to do like a lecture, and that's not always the best thing. So what can I do, since I'm a kinesthetic learner, what can I do that's maybe going to help me understand kind of this auditory input? You know, I can draw a picture, or I can get up and see if my teacher will let me stand in the back and kind of just, kind of go like this and write my notes. All those things are different ways that students can increase their opportunities to learn. Other things that they can do is definitely, it's not too early to start researching colleges, but especially careers. It's many times backwards to start thinking about college and majors without thinking about the career first, because that's what your end goal is. You're looking at a career that you want to end up in, but many times people are like, well, I want to go to Berkeley and I want to major in X, Y, and Z. Okay, what do you want to do with that? I don't know. What is that job? What job do you end up with that? I don't know. So that's kind of a backwards way to think about it. So we really start with 9th and 10th grade looking at the career focus. And Mr. Jameson, who is our career technician, he's really good, especially with our vocational and kind of career technical education areas, but he does a lot of career work with students and kind of exploration. So we kind of tag team, and I do a lot more ecology stuff, but we kind of hit both sides, kind of 1-2 punch them. Taking a rigorous schedule, as you can succeed with, okay? Balance is key. And this is important because as students get going forward, we don't want to overwhelm them. I look at students, and one reason why I don't do these 10th grade meetings that I'll require all 10th grade parents to come in and do this four-year plan with me and that kind of thing. One reason I don't do that as 9th graders is because I don't know your students. I don't know them academically. I don't know them personally. So being able to plan out 4 years of high school classes with them, seeing them for 2 weeks and having no transcripts, no grades, no experience with how they do in each class, makes it really challenging, and I would not be able to give you a very accurate four-year plan. So after I see them for a year, I'm able to sit down and actually build them a pretty true to your student, what I think they're probably gonna be capable of throughout the next 4 years. Obviously things change, they can get much better, or they can get much worse in terms of what they're pursuing academically, but that's why we don't do that, and so that will come in 10th grade. However, we do want students to take on challenging coursework, but there is something we said about limiting that challenge. There's only so much a student brain can take. We have to remember that they're developing, they have many other outside interests. Just think about your work environment. You know, if you had to work 8 hours and then you had to go home and work another 5 hours, you'd be pretty exhausted, and that's only after one day. Okay, so thinking about that is fairly important of kind of finding that fine balance. Parents, start saving for college. It's coming quick. If you haven't started now, you should definitely start. And it is expensive, let me tell you that. I can say because I have a bunch of student loans that are slowly being paid off. But also have students start looking into summer opportunities, things like jobs, but definitely like volunteer activities. If they're going to be a camp counselor or a volunteer coach or whatever it is, that's going to be more impactful for things like college than working at the mini golf course or something like that. Okay, one might help you pay for a car, one's going to help you get into college. You have to kind of figure out what your priority is. And again, come to meet with me. Have them come swing by. I want to meet them. I want to know who they are as a person and a student. It's my job to kind of be their friend, but also kind of to keep them guided and working on the straight and narrow. All right, let's see.
I'm sorry, but next year, will you see us at the end of this year for next year before
so,
you sign up for those classes?
So we can set up. Typically what I do is just like this year, many times most sophomores take a very similar type of set classes. It depends on what you're taking this year many times. So students in English Honors English 9 are many times going to take Honors English 10. Students taking Spanish 1 are probably going to take Spanish 2. Students taking Biology are probably going to take Chemistry. Students taking Integrated Math 1, they're going to take Integrated Math 2. So there's not as much kind of pressure for us to all sit down right away at the end of this year. I would definitely encourage you guys if you guys want to. I don't require it again because it's very standardized. The first 2 years are, we kind of do that on purpose to a certain sense because it lets students create that kind of that foundation that all the students kind of have the same experience and then they can branch out and really kind of explore kind of with a safety net of we kind of have you, we've got it made for you guys already for these first 2 years. After that, let's talk and let's see what we throw it against the wall and see what happens. And you know, you can take two science classes if you want to, but 9th and 10th grade year, we know enough about students that you know, unless you're going to change a language or you're like, I don't want to do honors English, I want to do regular English, most of the time it's fairly straightforward
okay.
In terms of what their course selections are going to be like. But yes, if you want to set up a meeting, definitely we can do that. Course selections typically start in about March.
Yeah.
Early.
Jeff, I noticed you didn't have on the last page, but something you told us with Garrett a couple years ago is start saving a folder of like a college
yeah.
resume that
yeah.
maybe you should.
So that's a good point. I probably took it out of there when I transferred this to Google Slides on accident. But yeah, you make a good point. So things that you're doing now, what students are doing now, you probably won't remember in 4 years. You'll try, and you will not. So anything that they do that's like, you know, you think is pretty cool, pretty awesome, pretty, you know, something that might add something to their applications or their resume or whatever they might want to do, awards, community service activities, times, places they went, that kind of thing, pictures, add it to a folder and just keep on adding to it and keep it somewhere safe. Because that will help you guys when you get to that senior year. You can look back at all 4 years, pull out some of those main milestones. It helps you possibly write a college essay. You might not think it now, but an experience you had as a freshman, you know, you won an award. You might not think about it now, but when you come back, you might, that kind of like did change my life. That is something I might want to write an essay about. And you have kind of the proof and information to back it up. Because when you get to those college applications, you don't want to fabricate anything. You don't want to make anything up. You want to have kind of like, they're not going to like ask you to fax in a copy of the award or anything, but you want to basically be as true to form as you can be. So keeping track of that is just a good practice to do. When you're doing that, when I talk about community service, keep those community service forms in there. We keep a copy, but trust me, we have so many pieces of paper. Things sometimes get misplaced on accident. If I don't have a piece of paper to prove that you did community service, you cannot graduate. Because it's a graduation requirement. I have to, board policy says I cannot let you cross that stage unless I have 30 hours of documented community service. If I don't have it, I'm turning to you and hoping you have it. So I tell all students and I'm telling all parents, please make copies and just keep a copy. If your kid does community service, make a copy of it. Take a picture of it on your phone, whatever it might be, and keep it in a safe place just in case a rainy day happens. We'll keep it in your CUM file here, but things happen. Fires, whatever. You want to be able to just keep that running record of what's going on.
It's just 6 hours per?
6 hours this year. I think that's coming up next. And we'll skip the PSAT. I do want to mention just quickly, we're running out of time, and I really apologize for keeping you guys so late. Normally I try to keep it 1 hour and a half at very maximum. So I'll breeze through some of this, but I would not be doing you guys a service by skipping over the 1 to 2. So students will have signs all around the campus. There's not one in here though, I need to put one up. But it's a big blue sign that says study 1 to 2 hours, okay? Students do not study enough. There's a national study that says students across the nation only study 19 minutes a week on average. I mean, there's much, a week.
A week.
Yeah. On average, that's across the country, okay? When I was at Cal Poly, they had a big campaign called the, I think it was the 35 to 45 or something like that, that they were saying you need to study 30 hours to 40 hours every single week during college. Okay, they did a week. I thought week was too broad for high school students, so I pared it down to an hour. So that means students should be studying 5 to 10 hours every week, okay? Might be more on one day, less on another. I give them Saturday and Sunday off. Okay, you know, if you don't want to study on Saturday or Sunday, that's your deal. I think every brain needs a break. However, if you have a test on Monday, I'd highly suggest putting in a little time over the weekend. But one thing that students don't really realize is studying is not just homework. They think, oh, I did my homework at school. I don't have to do anything at home. I'm expecting, and just so you guys know, you have my complete, you know, any power that I think I have, you have my complete blessing to make sure that they do 1 hour every single day, no matter what. They can come home and say, I worked so hard at school, I wrote 2 essays, I did 3 pieces of paper, and I did it all at school. Well, great. So what do you do for your hour? Let's research some colleges. Let's study for this test that's next week. Let's work on this project. Let's get ahead. Let's do some community service. Let's read. There's plenty of stuff that students can do every single night for 1 hour. I don't care when that hour is. I highly suggest much earlier than later. Students don't work very well late. They need sleep. However, we are expecting as a school, and I would hope that you would expect as parents, at least 1 to 2 hours every single night. Not only does this help them be successful in school, it preps them for college, and it preps them for those AP classes. Because guess what? When you start taking 2, 3, maybe even 4 AP classes, it's much more towards the 10 plus side a week. Okay, so they need to practice it. Just, you know, kind of just think about working out, or going to hell week during football practice. You don't want to do 500 pounds right off the bat. You probably can't do it. You start small. So start small as freshmen, teach them 1 hour every day, creates a habit. You know, you do it 21 days, they say, and it becomes a habit. Then it becomes less painful, and you see the benefits. Okay, so just have them practice this. Teachers should be starting to talk about it some, but I definitely talk about it with all the students whenever I see them. How's your 1 to 2 going? What'd you do last night for your hour of homework, for your study time? And I expect them to hopefully have an answer for me.
But homework does count.
Homework does count, yeah. So definitely, if they have assigned math work, have them do that. But you know, if they come home and say, I don't got anything to do, I'm gonna go skateboard, say, okay, after you do an hour. You know, you can go skateboard first, you gotta be home by 5 or dark or whatever, and we have dinner, and then you can do an hour after that. So you guys can set that up however you guys like as a family. But yeah, we expect 1 hour every single night.
Minimum.
You can do more, but 1 hour might be a good start for freshmen. Most of them might not need much more than that, and that's probably about as much brain time as they can handle. You might, if they need more, you might want to do an hour and take a break and do now, you know, half hour later or something like that. You start doing anything more than 45 minutes to an hour with 14, 15 year olds, their brains start exploding, melting out their ears.
Yeah, we can beat brain function and brain.
Yeah, so PSAT, I'm not going to cover that. That's not for freshmen. I used to do freshmen and sophomore together. I've kind of broken it all up because I wanted to. But they are changing. We'll go over that later next year. Community service, yeah, one we've all been waiting for. So we do have a graduation requirement. There are 2 requirements for community service, okay? And then, so one of them is your graduation requirement. So we require by the time, end of May, your senior year, that you have a cumulative total of 30 or more hours turned in, completed, documented, okay? So that's one requirement. I don't care if that 30 hours comes freshman year. If we have that 30 hours met, you're good for graduation. However, there is a second requirement. And this requirement is because we know students, we know what they do, many of them, not all of them, many of them, they wait until their senior year and then they try to do 30 hours in May. It becomes impossible. So we also have a yearly requirement. So this year, as freshmen, you'll be required to do 6 hours. Your Pathways teacher may have broken that up in half. They may say we need 3 hours from the fall semester, we need 3 hours from the spring. I'm not sure, every Pathways grade typically has a different policy, and sometimes the class itself develops that kind of expectation. But that grade is tied to your Pathways grade, or that those hours are tied to your Pathways grade. Again, the Pathways class is a pass, no pass grade. However, it does impact eligibility for sports, and it will go on your transcript. It's a 1-unit class. It does not affect your GPA, however, but if you start having 3 or 4 no passes on your transcript, trust me, colleges are going to see that. Okay, it's not going to affect your eligibility, but it will for college entrance. But it, you know, looking at like 4.0 and that kind of stuff, it will be a slight blight on your transcript. Okay, so that's kind of how we try to keep students on track and progressing through community service. So it is tied, there's two requirements. So if they do all 30, they still are going to be, for past pathways, they will still be expected to do 6 this year, 8, 8, 8. And then they just have 45 or 50 hours, which is even better. Okay, but that's the two requirements for community service. This year we are much more strict. Yeah.
What if community service is happening in the summer? What year is that attached to, and is that
I don't have a straight
possible.
Answer for you. Typically we will assign it to the coming year. It's much harder.
Okay.
We can't go back and change grades later for community service because school's
right.
out. We will typically put any summer hours after high school started. We don't really consider 8th grade community service hours in the summer before high school because, again, they're not our students. It's hard to keep, it doesn't really work that well. But say, for example, they did community service next summer. Most typically, we would cut off that pathways grade and community service requirement at the end of school in June. Any hours accumulated over the summer will be put towards the 10th grade next year hour requirement. So we do honor them. However, as long as they're school approved, like we would approve them. Obviously, there's probably not going to be people here to approve them. But you know, if you have an idea what that is, you might want to run a bias because there are certain things that will or will not count. And there's packets that all the Pathways teachers should be giving out at least by next week. We just hadn't had time to print them yet. That cover what that is. For example, you can't be volunteering for people that are getting profit out of it. So you can't, you know, volunteer and take flyers around and, you know, promote this event that people are going to make money off of. And it generally has to involve the community as a whole. You can't go move your uncle's stuff for free out
but
of his garage.
Like Sierra Century, right?
Yeah. Nonprofit, you know, Humane Society, Ski Swap, all that kind of stuff. And we do have some school-based events that we pre-approve that we're like, anybody can sign up for this. You know, we will automatically kind of give you all the blessing and you guys can get community hours. However, for other things, you know, if you're going to go work with a church group or something like that and go clean up trash on the side of the freeway, we require anything that's not school-wide, kind of blanket approved, we do require pre-approval. We will be, if you guys have older kids, we will be much more strict this year. In years past, since we've kind of been breaking this in, students hadn't quite known kind of the process, but we do require pre-approval that entails a parent signature and a Pathways teacher or school official signature. It doesn't have, you know, they meet twice a week with that teacher, so it could be me, it could be Ms. Mitchell, or they can find them at brunch or lunch. But that way we know, one, you guys are okay with them being on the side of the road, and if anything happens, you know where they're at, and it's not our fault, okay? And two, you guys know that, yes, what I'm doing will count for these hours. So we kind of cover both bases with those. And there's a form in that packet that they'll need to do for each community service. And if they're doing more than, like, if they're going, I'm going to volunteer every week at church or something like that with kids, or every week at Boys and Girls Club, they can do a pre-approval form for all those weeks and just count the time. So we don't need a form for every single time they do it. Just anytime they're doing something different. Okay? The Pathways teacher is the student point of contact. They're their first point of contact. I kind of oversee everything, and I'm actually kind of going to probably shove that off on Mr. Jameson a little bit. I'm kind of the person that keeps track of everything, but the Pathways teacher is going to be the person that, like, collects their forms, signs them, collects their hours, and inputs their hours. Okay? It sounds pretty confusing. Everybody's graduated with community service so far. It's not that hard. Just make sure that you're kind of following through it. When your kid brings home the community service packet, or we usually have them available in the front office, you can just give it a quick glance. It's kind of a brief overview of what is community service, what's not community service, and then that will probably give you enough information to get you through all 4 years so you know what is or isn't. If you have any question about is this community service, you can always email us or call us at school. We can say yeah or no.
Like the football team cleaning the barns for the fireworks, 2 hours this weekend.
Yeah, that should count.
Okay.
So the only thing that can't count for sports is if, like, they're mandated to do it. So if they can not show up and not get in trouble and not have to run lines and not have to do anything, then yeah, it will count. If they're going to be punished or not play or have to do laps at practice because they missed it because it's a team function, it will not count. And it cannot be during school. So they cannot skip school to do community service. Okay? Any other questions?
So they would have to fill out a form for them, 2 hours of football.
Yes, so it would be pre-approved.
It is
my child's
responsibility to go get a form.
Yes.
And have a sign.
Yes.
Turn it in.
Yes.
Okay, good luck with that. Just kidding.
Practice, remember? Practice and responsibility. They'll get it. You know, we're ninth grade is a soft place in land. We don't expect them to get it perfect right away. We want them to try. Okay? We will give them a little bit of a hard time if they don't, but that's just because we can, and it helps teach them. But we will also show them the right way and teach them how the correct way to do it. And hopefully through repetition and practice, they will get it. It might take them a whole semester, but that's okay. We'll get over it. Transcripts, you don't have anything on your transcripts right now, so we'll skip this until probably next year. I was just going to show you guys how to, when this was kind of the junior, sophomore, freshman thing, how to read grades and GPA, but we'll cover that next year when you guys actually have some transcripts to look at. I was going to show you this, but I think we're over time. And just a few key contact information. And again, I will put this, I actually don't think I made a PDF of this on the website yet, but I will do it tomorrow morning and upload it to that shared resource folder so you guys can download it. If you guys want a copy of it, you can also email me and I'm happy to attach it and send it out. So the school phone number, my direct line, I do not mind if you call me directly. However, just keep in mind, most of my time is sitting with people, sitting with students outside of my office. So if you get my voicemail, don't be surprised. I try to call back as soon as possible. Things like right now, it's taken me 3 or 4 days sometimes to get back just because I'm completely swamped. Later in the year, I'm usually much quicker. Email is the quickest way to get a hold of me. Okay. Goes to my phone, goes to my computer. I can do it in between meetings, whereas phone conversations, I usually have to have a chunk of time that I know I'm not expecting anything to happen. In an emergency, though, okay, do not call me, please. Call 911. You'd be surprised. Some people leave a message, my kid's got a knife or whatever. I'm like, okay, I get that 3 days later, and I got to follow up with that. And so it seems like common sense, but just know, don't. 911 is always kind of like your first emergency response. But there's also crisis lines because we're not open all the time. Okay, I do suicide intervention, you know, cutting, all that kind of stuff is part of my position and part of my job. However, I don't work all the time. Many times I'm unable to respond to that from home. If I get an email regarding that, I'll probably respond. I try to give you a call because I think that's the right thing to do. But I probably won't work with your student from home. One, I think it's unethical and it's kind of outside the purview of my position as a school counselor. But I will connect you guys with numbers of people that you could call if that's the circumstance. Hopefully you never have to use these. Any other questions? Thank you for giving me 5 extra minutes. If you have any other questions, I'm happy to stay. Yeah?
Just real quick, back up a little bit. That 1 year visual performing art requirement, mm-hmm. Is there a music band class that isn't at the 0 hour that kids can take?
Yeah, there's symphonic band and then wind ensemble. So symphonic band is what most freshmen and sophomores will take, and wind ensemble will be the class that most juniors and seniors will take. Unfortunately, it's not like a beginning level band. It's not really set up for students who are just learning an instrument.
What period is that?
It's third period.
Oh, it is? Okay.
So if your student plays an instrument, they can get in there, or they can take it in future years. Again, it's only 1 hour required, or 1 year.
Okay.
Any other questions?
I got a quick question about band.
Sure.
I know how much they push band in this school, and it's great.
Uh-huh.
And I know the band is great. My kid's doing band right now. He doesn't like it. He wants to do photography or something else. He said art. Those still count towards his electives for college, right?
Correct. So I mean, if he does band this year, that band class will probably first fall into that visual performing arts requirements, but if he wants to go do photo art, that becomes college prep elective and also falls into our elective graduation credits. Because
Losing anything if he doesn't.
No. You have multiple electives you can choose to take. Obviously, it will probably fill the spot if you wanted to pursue like multiple AP courses. It might take a spot of one of those if he chose to take a photography class, but it doesn't set him back any. He can always choose to take. We have room for electives for students to take. So you can do both.
So it's an elective.
Yeah. Any other questions? That answer that?
Yep.
Okay. Any other questions? All right. If you guys come up with anything, sometimes you get driving home and you're like, crap, I forgot to ask that question. Just email me or shoot me a phone call, leave a message or whatever. But thank you guys for coming. I appreciate it. Tell all of your fellow freshman parents to come next time. I'm always a little bit sad at the number of people that show up. I understand that there's stuff going on, but that's why I do the recordings. But it's very important information, I think, that you guys have. You guys should be armed for success.
Thank you.
All right, thanks, guys.
I can't complain. Oh, look at how cute that is. Oh, my God. Yes.